You ever heard the sock they make? It's a psycho bunny socks. Have you ever seen these socks?
No, I have not.
Psycho bunny?
It's like a sort of skull and crossbones bunny on the socks, and there's these high-end socks. I mean, they're not high-end. They're like $14 a pair or something.
That's pretty high.
Well, it's higher-end, but...
Yeah, what are high-end socks? What is
I don't know. I would guess high-end socks would be like $30 a pair, maybe $50 a pair.
Bergdorf, I've seen like $120 socks.
That's high-end socks.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. How did you guys hook up in the first place? Is this a one film relationship?
Whoa. Just for the record, we've never hooked up, okay?
Well, he
despite what he likes
it,
to tell
it was,
people.
It was a magic night for me. Go ahead. You can tell the Happy New Year story.
I was a fan of Larry's stage work, actually. Mm-hmm. And then we worked briefly together, both in very small roles and I as a producer on a project called Happy New Year. And that's when we hooked up.
The Henry Jaglom movie?
What's that?
Not the Henry Jaglom.
No, okay. Not that one. Different one of the same title.
Oh, the Gary of that film of that group, like the.
No.
You're thinking New Year's Eve, which is a Gary Marshall.
Oh, is that New Year's
film?
Eve? I can't keep up with.
Yeah,
no, this is an independent film about Iraq and soldiers and stuff.
It's about an Iraq War vet in a Walter Reed like VA hospital living in a PTSD ward.
So not a light comedy about the New Year's
super
Eve.
Cheery family movie.
Absolutely hilarious.
So you guys were in the war together, or
yeah,
we served together, right?
Yeah, except I mean, I guess you could call that production a war. I mean, most of them are.
But yeah, so we worked together on that, and we went to the festival South by Southwest and together, and I saw Carl swimming in his pink and like you have some sort of Speedo that's like
it was pink camo, like pink camo Speedo.
Yeah, it's really not good.
And, love at first sight.
He left them in my shower. In my hotel room. But anyway, and then
how the hookup rumor started.
Yeah,
pretty
it's
much.
True, it's
yeah.
true. Yeah, and I think it all started there.
But then you took a motorcycle trip home.
Oh, yeah.
From
well,
that
that's
festival.
It's interesting because this kind of loops into Pollywogs. It was at that festival when I was thinking about the idea for Pollywogs. And I discovered that it was cheaper to buy a motorcycle than it was to rent a car at South By because they jacked the prices up so high. And I was in the market for a motorcycle because my previous one had been stolen and I had finally paid it off. And I, you know, said to myself, I'm not going to get a new one until I pay off the old one. Mm-hmm. And then I used it for local transportation in Austin. And then I rode it back to New York. And on that road trip, I basically wrote Pollywogs. I mean, every night, you know, I had a long time to think as I'm just sitting there with the wind, you know, in some cases rain and thunderstorms.
Was there snow? I mean, that's still
there was no snow, but it got really cold once I hit Kentucky. But by the time I got to New York, I had a story outline. I had already talked to Ben Kosulke, who's our DP, and Kate, who plays the lead, and they had both said yes. So, you know, it kind of grew from there. And
did you have your piece from your phone in your motorcycle headset? Or?
No, it was when I pulled over.
Okay.
Yeah. That would have been cool. I mean, they make those things.
Kosulke!
Yeah. What?
So is Kosulke just the natural go-to guy for this kind of thing?
I think Ben's an awesome human being and an amazing cinematographer, and he works really well in the style in which we made the movie, which is... rigid story structure, improvised dialogue. We rehearsed, the four main actors rehearsed for 6 months before we shot it, so they had their characters down really, really well. You know, I had them like pick out houses and, you know, jobs.
There was a lot of backstory.
There was a lot of work we did.
Actory sort of work, you know, that nobody, it's really not that interesting. But Ben
works really well in this environment. You know, we shot with two cameras, and I dropped them in the middle of my actual family reunion. Mm-hmm. You know, and he's shot a lot of movies this way. So he in this case, yes, I think he is the go-to guy to get this type of, you know, movie finished.
And the truth is, notwithstanding his talent, he's the nicest man around.
He's like a giant teddy
bear. I watched this guy work, and, you know, because of the nature of the production, there would be some new person showing up. One person would have to leave. Who would be assisting him? So he would have to sort of reteach everything that he taught the day before. And he just was the nicest, most... I watched this happen, and I was like, you are a saint, and you really, and he's just such a great person. Like, we all understand his talent because it's ridiculously good at it. But it makes a huge difference that he's just so calm and like nice and yeah, man, whatever you need, and you know, and he didn't sleep a lot that whole shoot. But he was just like always in. He's like, sure, man, let's go shoot. Let's go do it. Let's, you know. I was just so impressed with him as a person and as an artist. It was so cool. It was really cool.
So how many days did you actually shoot?
Less than 2 weeks. I think it was like...
Less than 2 weeks.
Was it less than 2 weeks?
Well, I was there 10 days, and then you guys, I think you guys shot 15, along with the 2 days or so that you shot in New York.
So maybe about... 20 days total, but they were split up because there's kids in the movie, and we shot them a different weekend than.
So conceptually, you were going for Mike Lee. Is that where you're thinking?
I love Mike Lee. Yeah, I mean, I don't.
Not a lot of indies that shoot for 10 days or 15 days generally have 6 month rehearsal periods.
Right, and.
Well, we were rehearsing every single day.
Right.
I mean, but
yeah, we were. Yeah, it's not like, I don't think it was. We didn't have the luxury of the Mike Lee style where they were actually living as characters, and then we just sort of show up and, you know, poke a hole and into their world. I love Mike Lee. I'm an actor, so I love to work that way. And if I like to create environments that I think the actors will like, and I acted in the movie myself, so you know, if you're going to be making a movie...
I'm hoping people have seen the movie before they actually watch this interview, but
oh.
I'm sure some people won't, but I mean, I'm sure people will just be fans of yours, you guys, but oftentimes they actually have seen the film, so I assume they will figure that you can act.
Yeah.
They'd see your film, I hope.
Yeah.
That's the reaction they have.
Or not. And
if I can't, at least all of these guys were impressive enough to, you know, make me look good.
Well, we did, you know, there was an element of that because we all stayed at the lake house and lived there for 10 days. And the crew was, there was only like about five other people there that weren't in the movie.
Really
other than your family. Other than your family. And so at one point it just became this movie that you're making, and you kind of did start living the characters in a way, much like you're talking about, you know. We didn't, and we would,
true.
You know, we would rehearse. We rehearsed like once a week, and then we would come back with ideas, and we would and define the improvs more, and define the backstories more, and do all those kinds of things, and sort of come up with new things that maybe we could introduce into the film, and secrets that characters had from one another, and things that made it more dynamic as we were going. So by the time we got to Minnesota, you know, like Jenny Prediger, who plays my wife, and I, we had developed a lot of chemistry together, and Carl and I, who play best friends from growing up and all of that, had developed this really strong chemistry. And then Kate sort of came in as this mystery woman that we all hadn't seen in a while. And that was kind of true because she was in and out of the rehearsal process. Because of her schedule, she would sort of like come in and be this sort of mystic figure and then would disappear. And that was much like what happened when we got to set. It was like she was there and then we all had to, you know, sort of interact with it. It got very real. I mean, it was...
And that's really...
Her being in that environment, she probably wasn't having as much fun as the rest of you.
I can't speak
really
for her.
Not a really happy character.
Yeah, she did a lot of... I think she positioned herself well, not only in the rehearsal process, but when we were shooting the film. To the point where even me as a director, like, we would have the conversations we only needed to have. And for the most of the time, she was pretty much avoiding me. I mean, in a positive way, in a way that I think really helped the film until we got past there's one sort of like climax scene in the movie.
Right.
After that, you know, it was like we're all friends again. But she was great. And I think I didn't realize till afterward that that's what was actually going on and noticed how well it actually served the movie for her to really kind of be in it.
Because we all wanted to avoid Carl. Let's be really No, it was actually one of the better times I've had.
It was so much fun. You know, we would take a sauna every night before bed and go swimming, and the family would cook.
Can we just get over something really quick? You know the room where you sit and there's hot coals and stuff? What do you call that room?
Not the sauna.
Yeah, no, that's right.
What sauna, I would call it.
It's a sauna, right.
It's sauna.
Well, in the northern country where there are people that don't talk to each other for years and years and years on end, or because there's no light, They call it a sauna.
Yeah.
Sauna. Yeah.
Well, it's a Finnish word.
Right.
It's the only Finnish word in the English dictionary.
And we got in so much trouble.
Like, notable.
Yeah. The rule was you couldn't get in the sauna unless you called it a sauna. Yeah. I was like, I'm going to the sauna, and like we could, then you would get tackled. It was like very ugly. But anyway.
So the lore goes in Minnesota that
Minnesotan lore. Here you
Minnesotan
go.
Lore that
the lore goes sounded like it was actually some sort of group of
the lore goes.
The lore goes.
It sounds like a Dr. Seuss book. Yes. the lore is that
the troubadour here. Yeah.
There were saunas you could get laid at once upon a time. And in order to differentiate the ones that were just bathhouses and the ones that had hookers were saunas, and the ones that were not were saunas, pronounced the sort of traditional way.
And now you know why I wanted to go to the sauna.
Yeah. When he heard I was in there.
And how was your pronunciation of bathhouse?
Bathhouse?
Yeah, exactly right.
In New York, it's bathhouse. If you have sex, just a bathhouse, we're going to go to the shower.
If you're going to the wrong one of those, it's a whole different night.
It's a whole different experience.
A whole different night.
So when you were driving your motorcycle in the rain, as you're going home and coming up with this, I mean, were you like, I need to write something for me as an actor? Was it that I want to direct something and I will be an actor in it? Or, I mean, how does it fit into that mindset?
I have always wanted to do a story in northern Minnesota. I really find a lot of things about the culture up there interesting and unique. Mm-hmm. And since it's something I grew up in, I feel like it's something I know really well. And I haven't really seen a lot of stories that kind of portray this little microcosm of you know, northern culture, especially particularly
so not about
the Lakes. Well, yes, I wanted to act in it.
Well, it's like Mr. Duplass, who has also worked.
Exactly. Yeah, I want to.
He's written things just so he can have a decent role. You know, he couldn't find a good script, so he wrote something.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm an actor at heart, and that's really what I like doing. And I wanted to create a story that I could act in. Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, actually, it's fun, the uniqueness of the territory actually reminded me a little bit. I didn't know where the film was set necessarily.
Yeah.
As I was watching it, and was thinking of Canada.
Yeah,
it has that kind
well, it's
of,
almost
you know,
Canada. We're really
houses.
Close.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there's a whole that whole culture of the, you know, of those houses.
Uh-huh.
The away houses are is quite different.
Yeah. And there's 15,400 lakes in Minnesota. You know, like everyone pretty much has their own lake house. You know, it's not expensive to have a house on a lake.
So this was Sauna Lake?
This is Sauna Lake.
And you shot it at your family's house?
Uh-huh. My family's lake house. They have one in the town nearby as well. That's a little less rural, but you know, still it's only 18,000 people.
And one in Minnesota just for, or not Minnesota, Minneapolis, St. Paul, just to keep it interesting?
We don't have a house in Minneapolis, but yeah, ideally that'd be kind of fun.
So you come from rural people?
I do.
Relatively.
Miners. It's a mining town.
So were your parents, was your father a miner?
My grandfather was a miner. Huh. My mother was a miner for a while.
Wow.
Yeah. Iron mining.
So how did
something like 90% of the steel that went into World War II came from the earth under my hometown.
Which you see in the film, we jump off a cliff into the water. Those are old iron mines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an iron
filled
mine.
With water.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite the jump, too. But he went off the really, really high one. We have to jump out and far. Mm-hmm. We only jumped about 40 or 50 feet, I think.
Yeah.
But but those are old iron mines, and they're called, what are they called, the people?
Just pits.
Yeah, but you call the people, like, the iron people.
Oh, rangers.
Right.
Right?
Sounds
iron
like
rangers.
Something
it's
out of
the
Game
iron
of
range.
Thrones or something.
Like you need, like, a code book to go with this movie.
Kind of, yeah.
When people rent
that'd be a good
or
idea.
VOD it or buy it or whatever, they should get a little book with.
We'll do that.
I guess we don't really get into that too much in the movie, but it's all interesting. I mean, knowing that stuff makes watching the movie a little more interesting, I think. Just knowing about the area and, you know, sort of spotlighting these things about Minnesota that I wanted to make a character in the movie, I think is.
So how'd you escape?
By car. Went to Minneapolis as soon as I graduated high school, I went to Minneapolis for about a year and a half and then went to New York.
And New York is where things started to happen?
Yeah.
To find a career?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I started to find a career in Minneapolis, but it felt like
a
small town.
There's a kind of a cap there,
yeah. Yeah, even after a year, I was like, oh, you know, I'm ready for something bigger.
Unless you play every instrument and have, you know, women in your basement.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I got to hang out at Paisley Park a little bit, so that was fun.
Did you?
Yeah.
So is that like a part of...
He's very welcoming. Well, he was when he lived there. I think he now lives in L.A. and is a Jehovah's Witness. But when he was living...
So he comes to your house now.
Yeah. No, there have been stories where people have, you know, talked about how Prince has come to their door, like talking to them about, you know, the word of the Lord.
But see, if you use the eye hole, you can't see
it. Right. I have an eye hole where you're like, you open it up.
Nobody's here. Trick or treat. Yeah.
Okay. So was that like a rite of passage for young Minnesotan boys? To the Prince's house?
Well,
touch the machines?
I think young Minnesotan boys who are interested in the arts, perhaps, he would have these parties.
I didn't mean it in a Michael Jackson way. I just actually literally meant
right. Touch the what again? Yeah, well, that's where I was going with it.
That's out here.
He would just, it would be word of mouth, and he'd be like, oh, this Friday we're going to have a party. And a party at Prince's place was him playing for everybody and like having guest people like fly in, and you know, there was some like iconic bass player that whose name I don't know who was there as the guest that night, and you know, Prince shows off and plays all the instruments, and you know, they give, there's free food, there's an open bar, and you just, whoever shows up gets in, and it's like the first 200 people to show up just get in.
When somebody remakes Gatsby again, this sounds like the
Prince
story. They should go and use Prince.
They'll do it in Minnesota maybe.
Yeah,
Gatsby in Minnesota.
It'd be fun.
The great elegance of...
Can you imagine what the next incarnation of Gatsby is going to be? I mean, after the Lerman
I didn't see the Baz Luhrmann one yet.
But this one was actually... People won't realize it. It was a huge hit. This is by, like, double the highest gross he's ever had, Baz Luhrmann.
Really?
And, yeah, it's like $350 million worldwide.
Wow.
Big movie.
Holy cow.
Even for Leo DiCaprio, it's one of his bigger movies.
Which is
no shit.
When you think about that, you don't realize, but it's true. It's just kind of astonishing. Like,
Everybody's kind of like down on it, and you know, I mean, it's interesting with critics because critics tend to be in their 50s or late 40s or whatever.
Right.
It's not really the age group for, you know, mixing with, you know, Gatsby with Jay-Z.
Yeah.
they were not having any of it. You know, they were going
to piss all over. I'm going to see it. I need to say, I love Baz Luhrmann. I'm often embarrassed to say that one of my favorite movies of all time is his Romeo and Juliet. I mean, I think it's a remarkable movie.
Yeah,
it's
especially if you really know like Shakespeare,
and you
know what he did with the text and all the names of the swords,
so good.
And all that kind of stuff. It's really amazing.
I've probably watched that movie more than any other movie ever. They had a 35 print of it when I was in San Francisco, and I missed it.
That and The Notebook is his other favorite.
Well, Gosling, you know.
Yeah.
What can you do? Even straight men are, you know, drawn to the light.
Sears every time. Yeah.
But there are very few directors who are allowed to be artists inside the studio system at these prices.
Right,
you know?
And he is.
And one of them gets away with it, yeah.
It's true.
It's kind of breathtaking. Even that should make us more encouraging of him, but yet people are just waiting.
I don't know why people are so down on him. I mean, I feel like Romeo and Juliet was probably his opus.
Well, Australia is really the only bad movie he's made, and, you know, I'll say that out loud, because that's watch, but...
I don't think I've seen Australia.
I think is really like a rough, bad movie. I mean, Moulin Rouge is a good movie, and Strictly Ballroom is a terrific movie.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, but I think that what sets people off, listen, I don't know, I mean, but I think that people don't like, you know, sort of, this is really specific style, because you're either into it or you're not.
Yeah.
And it's, and it doesn't apologize, and it makes no, you know, sort of qualms about what it is. It's really specific and really like you're in it, and it's really immersive, which I enjoy, and I think it's really intelligent and smart. But I think, you know, unless it has spaceships in it, and you know, my brother's like that. He's like, it doesn't have spaceships in it.
Yeah.
And, you know, aliens. I'm not watching anything. I'm not watching that shit. I said, oh, okay, well then don't go see anything I'm in, because you know, unless I'm wearing, we could put an alien in the sequel. Yeah, we have big spaceships in Pollywogs.
Yeah. Yeah. Aliens. But frog aliens.
You're either into it or you're not, I guess. And some people, it freaks them out. You know?
Do you guys like being part of this indie universe? Is that
where
it should be? As opposed to like chasing after the studio dream of making Adam Sandler?
I mean, what is the studio dream anymore? I'm not even really sure.
More money. Lots and lots of money.
Yeah.
Time.
But I mean, money's nice. I don't necessarily have a goal of like amassing unimaginable wealth personally. I would, but you know, it'd be nice to be able to have a nice car and
I mean, it's like a $40 million budget. Like, that'd be really, you know, I could change the world with $40 million, or is it the same movie just done with a lot more money?
I think it's And often, you know, often it's just the same movie done with more money. I mean, the primary difference is what? That you can have more explosions and great CGI and, you know, all that kind
of
stuff.
Well, they make a lot of dramas for $40 million these days. It's not, you know, they spend a lot on comedies that don't have CG. And
I mean, that's a pretty baseline budget
for a studio.
Dollars.
Yeah.
That's, you know, that's
a cheap movie for a studio.
That's a cheap movie, yeah. I sort of, I mean, I don't think my goal is to make unimaginable wealth. But it's also not to be an unimaginable debt either,
right?
You know? And these movies, you better love it because you're not making, you know, tons of money on them by any means. But I do think that the focus is on storytelling and in the right spots. I really think that the focus is in the right area in terms of character-driven stories and actual stories that are interesting and shots that are interesting and interesting worlds, you know, like Sun Don't Shine. If you've seen Sun Don't Shine,
is Amy was sitting
right there. Is an amazing.
Amy sat right over here for.
Oh, cool!
Yeah, it's an amazing, like, total ride in its own little world, and done in a way that's really unique and interesting and really fascinating and great acting. I mean, Kentucker's great. All those people are great, and I think that that's cool because you can do all those things. And you can still focus on the story without all the other shit getting in the way, you know? Oftentimes, you know, big budget stuff, it's like, it's just, there's so many people running around trying to prove that they're worth some money. It's like, you know, you lose track of what the story is and what you're doing. There's so many chefs in the kitchen, you know?
It's true. You know, there's a phenomenon that kind of happens once you pass a certain dollar threshold where the type of people that you start working with, I think, are more there for the paycheck than they are for the love of the craft. And that's what's nice about working with small budget levels, I think, is because you know that people are only going to be doing it if they really are sort of in line with your goals for the movie. And I think, budget aside, well, I guess it was partially because it was such a small budget. Everyone we had on this crew had that passion, you know, and there's no way that we would have gotten this done, I think, if we didn't have that kind of passion behind it.
I mean, is the boat getting a little full of people who are out making these kinds of movies, do you think?
I don't think so, because I think everyone's careers are constantly changing. I mean, the Duplass brothers aren't making these kinds of movies anymore. They're making much bigger budget movies.
Only on weekends.
Yeah. Swanger is making people.
Joe just made Drinking Buddies. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's like.
Amy's on the AMC.
Amy's on fire. And she's doing all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
But, you know, the cool thing about the sort of digital revolution that's happened in the last 5-6 years, I mean, really it's blown up so much, is that everybody can do it. The bad thing is that everybody can do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like any jackass can go buy a camera and submit it to a festival, and it just adds to the stacks of shit that you have to sift through to get to the good stuff. You know, I was talking to somebody that runs a film festival, and they said that literally 5 years ago they had 1,200 submissions, and last year they had over 6,000. In the last 5 years, you know, so if you're trying to, even if your film is, you know, super genius, you still have to sift through all of that shit to get to the good stuff. And I think that that's where it's becoming oversaturated. And there's too many,
but you know
what?
There's
so many film festivals now. It's like always, there's a film festival in every fucking town.
It's getting much more democratized as a result, the two. I think the people who are able to make good stories, who may not have had access to, you know, film 20 years ago are able to sort of shine through, and then
right, that's the good side of it.
Yeah.
And then the bad side of it is
kind of great.
You know, everybody's like, "Oh, I got a camera, dude." You know.
Yeah, but look at all these submission fees they're paying. It just helps us out, right? Because the festivals get to pay for us to go to Skywalker Ranch, for example. Right. You know. Let's look at the positive things here.
So was that the greatest experience ever? LAFF is like famously. That's
I was
like
being a Debbie Downer. I was just saying, like, there is some saturation point.
Yeah, it's true. I agree with you completely.
A little bit, you know.
Well, even 10 years ago, I was running a festival in Miami, and I going through submissions and didn't have 18,000 or whatever, but I had a lot. And like, I found this film that was great, and I didn't believe. I wasn't really sure. Because I'm in a room by myself with a video player, you know, back when there was video. Mm-hmm. And it was like, after you watched 30 other movies in the last day and a half, and you're like, is this really as good as I think, or is it just much better than the other crap, you know, the other 29 terrible movies?
Right. You're like, oh, wow.
This and, one... you know, it's that the style, the handheld camera and all that, and you're kind of like, am I just hallucinating? And fortunately, I showed it to other people, and they all agreed with me, so it worked out. But it's a weird feeling when you kind of like, your judgment is a little lost because you have such a big pool to swim through.
Yeah.
That's
a hard job. God bless the programmers, man. Seriously. Like, they've got the hardest job right now, as far as I'm concerned.
So, Skywalker Ranch.
Did
you get to go to Skywalker? Or you...
No, I didn't. Thanks for bringing it up.
It's only, it's only directors. It's they're, only they're directors. Only feature directors.
I tried to infiltrate it. I was sneaking it. No, I didn't.
You have your own helmet, your own outfit from the movie?
Charging with a lightsaber.
If you know why Skywalker Ranch is so awesome, is because you get to spend time with all the filmmakers and really get to know each other and get to sort of root for each other's movies. It's unique.
Sounds like the process for making this movie.
Yeah.
You can make a movie with all the other filmmakers from the...
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure I'm, you know, going to have collaborations with some of the people I met at this sleepaway camp. It was great. You know, it's just like, it kind of was like making the movie. We were all sleeping together in the same, you know, facility. We all have breakfast together. We're hanging out by the pool.
You brought the pink Speedo, I guess?
This one was like had flames on the side.
Very nice.
Yeah,
so those were actually tattoos. Yeah, he added them permanently.
Yeah. So the response to the movie you made the movie, you went through all that stuff, then you finally start showing the movie. We haven't started showing the movie yet.
This is going to be the world premiere tonight.
And it's tonight. I thought you already did it there.
No, it's tonight. So
are you peeing your pants? Is that the
Only because of this large glass of water that you gave me. Otherwise, no. I'm really excited. I mean, you know, we make movies to show movies. So I've been waiting for this day for, you know, 2 years, a little over 2 years.
So there's no downside for you. You're just happy you're here and you're going to show your film. And
I mean, what would be the downside, really?
Well,
you know, I can't see a downside. I'm really looking forward to showing the movie, and I'm looking forward to showing it. You know, hearing people's responses for better or worse. You know, I like when people think about what I've put on the screen and, you know, what we've made together on the screen. And I'm hoping, for me, it's a success if someone takes away some sort of passion about the movie, you know, a passionate opinion about the movie for better or worse, honestly. You know, I feel like someone could walk out of the theater loving the movie and it can create positive change in their life, or, you know, someone could walk out of the theater hating the movie and they'll still be thinking about it, you know, and I think this movie probably does that. I mean, did you watch the movie?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure. I mean, did you
not
think
at a festival screening, apparently.
Yeah. what was your reaction to it in terms of, you know, did you love it? Did you hate it?
Did I hate it? No, I mean, it's funny because for me, it's a piece of a puzzle movie. Ultimately the focus for me shifts to her.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the mystery is not ever really resolved in a way that, you know, like take away, okay, here's the answer to the movie.
Right. Interesting.
So it's like, that's what I find interesting. I mean, I think that is for me, when it's good, the joy of this kind of filmmaking.
Yeah.
Is that you don't have to have an answer. You don't have to have a punchline. You don't have to have, and for me, that's the journey is what the movie experience is, more than the, did I come out loving or hating it? I mean,
interesting.
It's for me not a love-hate movie. I don't know how I feel about you. I mean, as an actor, as a performer, that character.
Yeah.
Because I think that, you know, you go through, you kind of wonder as it's, and I'm like giving a speech, but.
It's all right. I like it.
You kind of wonder what he is. First, you're not sure whether he's really sincere, and then he is sincere. I actually went back and watched, because I had the benefit of not having
right.
been in a movie theater and watched and stay for another show. I actually went back and watched a couple scenes again to see whether there was something I was missing about, like, a key turn that I wasn't catching.
But you didn't find anything?
No. No, what I found was this the mystery of human life, which is sometimes somebody's going somewhere, and then they just all of a sudden aren't there anymore, and you're not really quite sure why. And, you know, I think your character isn't a guy who's doing anything terrible. You're trying to do something good.
Right.
And I think that's what's interesting about the film. No.
Cool. Yeah, yeah. I mean, what's interesting?
From your mouth. It wasn't a test. I don't think
there is a right answer.
Well, it's hard when a director asks you what you thought of their film.
Yeah, it is kind of.
It is tough. I'm sorry I put you on the spot, but you know, I'm genuinely interested. It's just great to see what people latch onto because everyone is totally different. And there's usually a gender divide, actually, in terms of latching on to the story of Dylan or the story of Sarah. So you've crossed the gender line. I think you're the first one who was sort of more interested in her story, or
probably because I'm old.
Yeah.
I know him.
Right.
All these years, it's not really
right.
that
and
hard
it's not,
to imagine
it's,
him.
Okay.
He's not that unique. He is. You know.
Right.
He's just the guy trying to get through
get
things.
Get his shit together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she's carrying stuff.
Yeah.
And so that's what. To me, that's where I start looking at that.
Interesting, yeah.
So
that's great.
You guys were fun too, but
we're the people that never left. That's what we exist for.
Well, I mean, there are a lot of people that latch onto your story too.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, what happened? I want to see what happens when they get in the car together and drive away.
Jenny punched me right in the face.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen the movie, you won't know why.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're excited but not worrying about dick measuring tonight?
No.
You're kind of like, you've done your work. And generally, in terms of your work, is that how you feel about it? That you've once you've done
at
it,
this
you've
point,
had the experience,
I mean,
you've done it?
Yeah. I mean, at this point, this is my first feature as a director, so I guess this I haven't really formulated an opinion about that.
I'm sure
but
as
that's
an actor
how I feel.
Also, there's kind of that.
Yeah. I mean, what can you do? Once it's on the screen, once it's done, it's done. And you just got to kind of help it along and support it. And I mean, I see people get bent out of shape about the reviews or what they could have done differently. And I don't think that's positive experience for yourself, really, to put yourself through that, right?
Well, I mean, it's how some people get. It's amazing the things that people do to get through.
It's true.
Some people like abuse. Some people,
Yeah.
Nobody wants to admit it.
Yeah.
Well, and ask us these questions tomorrow.
That's it. Right now, I'm happy because no reviews have come out yet.
Yeah, I think it's kind of exciting. You don't really know what to expect. I mean, no large audience has seen the film, and it's a. It's a taste. You're either gonna like it or you might hate it. I don't know if that's true, but it's not like I don't know that it's a crowd pleasing sort of big stompy movie or anything.
Not a
like
four
that.
Quadrant hit.
Yeah. So, it's an independent film. It has very much that quality, and hopefully people will respond to it in positive ways. I hope, but it is kind of. I wouldn't say nerve-wracking, but it's a little untested. We're sort of, sending the boat off in uncharted waters and just going to sit back and listen and see what people think. And if they all get up and leave before the Q&A, then I guess we know. But
you guys
I don't think
that'll
happen.
Together.
Huh?
What's that?
You listen to you guys, it's like it and ego sitting on the couch together.
Which one's which? Yeah. we sometimes trade cards. It's like, okay, you did it. I'm kind of excited about that too, though. That's always kind of exciting, whether mm-hmm. you're doing any project, the first time you put it out there, whether it's a play or a screenplay or a movie or any of that. The first time, you don't have no idea how people are going to react.
It's going to be fun. I'm excited. My mom and my sister came out here for it.
Yeah,
it's
great.
As you know, did you know that? Yeah, that's my actual family in the movie. Like,
I did not know that.
Yeah.
But I think I guessed at it.
Yeah, yeah.
So as long as you don't,
they're the best actors in the movie. They really are. They're outstanding. Yeah, they're really
amazing.
So as long as they don't leave the sauna, you're okay.
Yeah.
Sauna. Weren't you really excited? There was that commercial, or they say that progressive commercial. It's like a sauna in here when the guy's pants are on fire.
Oh, I didn't see that one.
Oh, well.
Wow, you should.
I was so excited because I said, oh, he said it right. And I only knew that because I was in a sauna in Minnesota. By the way, if you've never done that, you should absolutely get this experience in your life. Sit in a sauna and go jump into a 55-degree lake at night.
Isn't it supposed to be able to kill you?
No.
Don't people have heart attacks from that kind of thing?
Well, I'm sure somebody has somewhere along the line, but we didn't.
But people have had heart attacks driving, too. I mean, does that stop you from driving?
Things will shrink on your body like you haven't seen before, but that's okay.
Part of the
but it is
part of the charm. We cut a hole in the ice in the
Yeah, okay, I didn't do that.
In the winter. And
I was not.
It's warmer than the snow. You know, it's still liquid at least. So. Hmm.
That's the really selling point. It's warmer than the snow.
That should be the tagline for the movie.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. It's warmer than the snow. Everybody, it's warmer than the snow. That's all we have to say. Pollywogs.